Good afternoon. Our first hymn this afternoon references Romans chapter 11, and we'll just read those last few verses of Romans chapter 11. Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. For who hath known the mind of the Lord? Or who hath been his counselor? Or who hath first given to him, and it shall be recompensed unto him again? For of him, and through him, and to him are all things. To whom be glory forever. Amen. Turn in your hymnals to number 111. Hymn number 111, if you're able, stand with me as we sing, And Can It Be, 111.
Thank you.
us. Would you lead us in prayer, please?
Heavenly Father, we're grateful that we can sing this to you. We stand in awe, stand in fear. Amazing that you would redeem us. And though we cower before your righteousness, we are reminded that our sins are paid in full. That if we accepted Christ's payment on our behalf, so we can stand boldly before you and call upon you and worship you. Lord, we'd be amiss not to stand in peace before you. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you for Christ. Thank you that we can stand and sing the song together. Thank you for bringing us together today through your word. Thank you for ministering to allow us to part of Carpenter's Project, that you would continue to work through them, through us, part together. And we always remember that it's you who's doing the work. Pray these things in Christ.
You may be seated. Turn to number 611. 611, another song about what the Lord has done for us and what we can be amazed at what he has done. Coming down from the ivory palaces, as this song puts it. 611, out of the ivory palaces. To number 285 as Abby Billman comes to play for us.
Thank you.
Number 346 is next. I Stand Redeemed, 346. Is next 316, My Jesus Fair.
Thank you.
We have the privilege of having Brother Rodney Fitzsimmons with us, and he's going to come and share the ministry with us.
Let me just do this here.
When it comes to these things, I should have been a caveman. We had it all set up. I don't know. I'm clicking on it and nothing's happening.
He's scrolling over here.
Are you ready to play?
Oh, yes. There you go.
Are you ready to play now?
Yeah, go ahead. Okay. I'm sorry.
In 2001, God burdened my heart for missionaries who are taking the gospel to the unreached. God did not burden me for a particular country or people, but to help missionaries and nationals reach the lost. In 2001, God burdened my heart for missionaries who are taking the gospel to the unreached. God did not burden me for a particular country or people, but to help missionaries and nationals reach the lost through church planting and evangelism. And since its inception, the Carpenters Project has assisted church planters in the Americas, Africa, and Asia. Recently, God answered our prayers for help and led missionary Rodney Fitzsimmons to join the ministry.
For 32 years, my wife, Kathy, and I were missionaries to Haiti. During that time, God richly blessed our ministry. Now, due to Kathy's health, we are no longer able to live in Haiti. But God has provided the opportunity for us to continue to minister to the Haitian people and to others around the world through the Carpenters Project. Paul instructed Timothy to teach faithful men the truths he had received so that they would be able to teach others also. We believe that the key to establishing local, indigenous, New Testament churches is training nationals for the ministry. Equipped with sound doctrine, they can go under the authority of their local church to plant churches where the Lord leads them. The Carpenters Project partners with American missionaries and indigenous local pastors who are training nationals to go forth and establish Bible-believing churches through evangelism, discipleship, and teaching those called to the ministry to go and do the same.
Through partnerships with indigenous Bible institutes, the Carpenters Project assists graduates who are called to a church planting ministry. The Timothy Project provides temporary financial support to national pastors who are starting a church in a small town or rural area. Although the national may be from the same country and often a familiar ethnic group, they are considered outsiders and need time to gain the acceptance of the people. The Carpenters Project has partnered in several dozen church plants in the Caribbean, East and West Africa, and Asia.
We believe it is still the mission of the church to preach the gospel to every creature. Therefore, we assist pastors and their churches in their evangelistic outreaches. We sponsor open-air evangelistic services as churches reach into unevangelized areas. Teams of church workers travel to these areas and stay for several days to share the gospel with those who have never heard. These meetings are often accompanied with teaching and activities during the daytime, especially for children and young people. We also work with nationals in several countries to reach lost souls by providing equipment for a film ministry. Films that give a clear presentation of the message of salvation through Christ are held both indoors and outdoors to many who otherwise might never hear. It is so important that national workers have gospel literature to distribute as they endeavor to reach lost souls. We help provide these servants with Bibles, New Testaments, John Romans, and gospel tracts for their evangelistic outreaches. We regularly visit these fields to spend time with the pastors and see their ministries. While there, we hold Bible conferences and teaching seminars, as well as revival and evangelistic services.
The Carpenters Project has worked in more than a dozen countries and participated in the construction or renovation of more than 80 buildings. Having a permanent place of worship is critical for the growth and stability of a new church. For many church planters in undeveloped areas, it's a daunting task. Once a church obtains land, designs a suitable building, and recruits volunteers to provide some or all of the labor, the Carpenters Project helps by providing funds for the purchase of the building materials. Churches have asked us to help with buildings, small and large, made with brick, block, or wood, and built on flat land, hillsides, and mountains.
When Jesus saw the multitudes, his heart was moved with compassion for them. He said to his disciples that the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. So he told them what must be done. We must pray for the Lord of the harvest to send forth laborers into his harvest. The Carpenters Project exists to train nationals for the ministry and then assist them in establishing churches to reach lost souls, disciple converts, and train these disciples to do the same. When you pray and give to the Carpenters Project, you are helping to send laborers into the harvest.
If you'd like, we may have time for a couple of questions, if you'd like to ask anything at all to come to your mind today about the ministry or whatever. If not, I guess I've done a fairly decent job.
Explain how stateside churches are involved with you.
Okay, we have churches and individuals, for that matter, that support the ministry monthly. Sometimes they designate it to the Timothy Project. Now, the Timothy Project is where we will support a national for 5 years. Every year, it drops off 20%. At the end of 5 years, then there's no longer support. And this is designed for them then to teach their people the grace of giving, and they would support their pastor. We have churches that give specifically to that and individuals. Then we have that just give to an undesignated, so that goes into a fund. And whenever we have a small need comes across, we're able to provide for that need without having to mention it in our newsletters. Then we have churches and individuals that give just for special projects. Whatever we mention in our newsletter, a building, books for pastors, Bible printing. We're not a humanitarian organization, but there have been times when ministries that we help have been faced with crises, war, natural disasters, whatever, famine. And, we want to help them in these times of need. And so we have had people give to humanitarian. Whatever we get, 100%, if it's designated, 100% goes to that project. And we have churches or individuals that sometimes maybe do both. They'll support us monthly as well as give to special projects. So just whatever the Lord lays on people's hearts, when we send out the newsletter, we just ask people to pray. And we know people are praying because inevitably the needs are met, and we just send it on. Okay. I noticed quite a few people signed up for our newsletter. The literature back there is for you to take so you can be more familiar with the ministry. And if anybody else would like to sign up, once a month you'll get the newsletter by way of email. And again, this is simply for our asking you to participate in the ministry through your prayers. All right, yes, sir. Yes, we put the needs in the newsletter. We try not to put more than one major one each month, maybe a smaller one as well. It just depends on what we're facing at the time, but what we put in the newsletter is what we're really focusing on at that time. Okay. Let me just say that I have, you know, everywhere I travel, whether it be in foreign countries or here in the States, my desire is just to be a blessing and an encouragement, but I always feel like that I leave with more than I gave, and I already know that's going to be true my time here with you. I was blessed to be in the pastor's home yesterday evening and a delicious meal that his wife prepared. I'm grateful for that and the fellowship. The overnight accommodations were very nice. It was a blessing to be in the services today. I've been touched by the music. It's been the piano music, the special music, and just the hymns. It's been a real blessing. And I kind of feel like the Haitians do. You ask a Haitian, what's your favorite food? He says, whatever I find. And that's kind of how I feel about the hymns. What's your favorite hymn? Well, it depends on what I'm singing at the time. But how can it be? You can't get much better than that. So that was a blessing. And thank the family the Swishers that provided the meal for me today. That was a blessing too. And I thank you for the fellowship I enjoyed around the table also. So it's been a real joy to be here. All right, turn your Bibles this afternoon for a few moments. To 2 Corinthians chapter 8. I asked someone before I came in to speak, do you do this every Sunday? I thought you did. So you're used to not getting your nap around this time of day. Is that right? Okay. Some of them. All right. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Let's begin here. We're going to look at quite a few verses here. Let's look at verse 7. He says, therefore, talking to the church at Corinth, therefore, as ye abound in everything, in faith and utterance and knowledge, and in all diligence, and in your love to us, see that ye abound in this grace also. He's referring here to the grace of giving. And that's what we want to look at this afternoon. Let's pray. Father, this day we are so grateful for the time we've had together, the fellowship, the time of refreshing, Lord, as we've drawn closer to you. And Lord, we've worshiped you and sensed your presence in our midst. We pray, Lord, for your blessing upon this ministry, the pastor and his family, and each of the faithful workers in the church and members, Lord, and the light that this church is here in this community. And Lord, it's getting so much darker in this world we live in today, even in our country. But Lord, we are the light. You told us before you left that we are the light of the world. So help us to be faithful and shining, and I pray, Lord, that your word would be a blessing and encouragement to us this afternoon. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now, Paul is dealing in this passage of Scripture with an offering that he was taking up among the Gentile churches to take back to the church at Jerusalem because they were suffering from a famine and from just hard times. The Christians were being persecuted by their fellow Jews that were not believers. And the church at Corinth, when Paul first presented this to them, they were all for it. They said, man, we want to do this. We're excited. And when Paul would go to other churches, he would talk about the zeal of the church at Corinth to do and be a part of this giving that he was receiving. But then they kind of fell behind. And he found out they weren't prepared. They weren't ready. They hadn't done what they had promised that they would do. And he was afraid that if he went there, that they would be embarrassed. He wouldn't be embarrassed if he had others with him that he had told about their zeal. And so he writes this passage of scripture to encourage them to do what they promised they would do. And he uses in this passage of scripture the churches of Macedonia. The churches of Macedonia is an area, a province, so to speak. And the churches of Macedonia were Philippi, Thessalonica, Berea, and maybe others, but those were the predominant ones. He uses their example because they had come after, they were encouraged by what Paul said about the Corinthians. They had got behind it, and they had done what they said they would do. So he uses their example to encourage the church at Corinth. So I want us to notice here is some principles that apply to giving. And though this was referring to the giving to the poor saints at Jerusalem, it can apply to any aspect of our giving in the Christian life. It can be to our regular giving to the local church. It can refer to our giving to a special project, a building program, missions, helping the poor, whatever it might be. These are Bible principles of giving that can apply in any area of giving in our church and in our ministries. So what are these principles? Now, I've got seven, but don't get afraid now. We'll get done on time. Okay, I'm pretty close to it anyway. First of all, notice verse 1. Moreover, brethren, we do you to wit of the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. The first one we find here in this verse, and they all start, I tried to make it easy. I don't always alliterate, but if it works, I will. The first one is, it is a sharing experience. A sharing experience. You say, well, I understand that. We are in a wonderful country, a developed country, a wealthy country, and God has blessed us, and we need to share what we have for the sake of the gospel to go around the world. Well, what you have said is true, but that's not what we're talking about here. It is a sharing experience. It is a grace that God allows us to be a part of. In fact, it is God sharing with us the opportunity to be involved in His work by our giving. It is a sharing experience, a gift of God. And any grace that we received is a grace of which we are not worthy. And yet God allows us to have a part in His work. As I said earlier this morning, we get to. It's not that we have to or we need to, which those are true, but we get to. We get to be a part of what God is doing around the world as we give to the ministry. That's number one, a sharing experience. Number two, look at verse 2. How that in a great trial of affliction, talking about the churches of Macedonia, the abundance of their joy. Now that sounds like what they call a paradox. Two truths that just don't fit. One seems to negate the other. I mean, they're in a great trial of affliction, and yet they are abounding in joy? How's that possible? Well, the key here is the fact that the joy of the believer does not depend upon our circumstances. The Apostle Paul wrote the book of Philippians from prison. And you would assume the theme there is going to be, how do you suffer? But it's not. The theme of Philippians is rejoice. And he was in prison. The joy of the believer is not based upon our circumstances. They change. The joy of the believer is based upon the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And regardless of what your circumstances may be, in Christ we can still have joy in our heart. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The joy here of these believers was abounding even though they were in a great trial of affliction. And Paul, remember, one of the churches was the church at Philippi? Paul had showed them this. Remember when he was in prison with Silas? What were they doing? At midnight, singing and praising the Lord. Their joy was in the Lord, and that's where our joy needs to be today. So it's this giving of the churches of Macedonia, it springs from their joy in the Lord in spite of their affliction. And then notice number 3. Continue reading in verse 2. Their deep poverty. Notice he says deep, not just poverty, but deep poverty. abounded unto the riches of their liberality. Again, here, two statements that just don't seem to fit. They were in deep poverty, and yet they were abounding in their liberality. Number three, it's sacrificial. It's sacrificial. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 7 says, "There is that maketh himself rich, yet hath nothing. There is that maketh himself poor, yet hath great riches." See, it depends on who's judging. There is that maketh himself rich, that's in the world's eyes. And yet in God's eyes, he has nothing. There is that maketh himself poor in the world's eyes, and yet in God's eyes, he has great riches. We see that in the book of Revelation, the churches there, Smyrna, remember Smyrna? He said, "I know thy poverty, but thou art rich." In the world's eyes, they were poor, but God saw them as rich. Then there was a church at Laodicea. God said, they said, "We are rich and increased of goods and have need of nothing." God says, "And thou knowest not that thou art wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked." So, it all depends on whose perspective you're looking at it through. They gave liberally, even though they were in deep poverty. Verse 3, he says, "For to their power I bear record, yea, and beyond their power, even more than what you would have expected, even more than what you would, that they even had the ability to do, they did even more. They were willing of themselves," verse 4, "praying us with much entreaty that we would receive the gift and take upon us the fellowship of the ministering to the saints," again referring to the saints in Jerusalem. It's almost as if, you get the idea there when you read verse 4, "praying us with much entreaty." It's almost as if when these churches of Macedonia, when they brought their offering to the Apostle Paul and said, "Here is what we have received for you to take to the believers in Jerusalem," is Paul kind of, you know, "Hey, I know your situation. You guys are having a hard time. You guys are in difficult times." And it's as if they begged him and said, "No, Paul, you've got to take this. We want to be a part of helping our believers in Jerusalem, praying us with much entreaty that we would receive the gift." It's sacrificial. They begged Paul, "Take it. We want to be a part of this." Then number 5, how could they be? How can all this happen? How can these men, people in affliction, be abounding in joy? How can they in deep poverty give of the riches of their liberality, begging Paul to take the gift when they needed it just as much as the people in Jerusalem? And the key is verse 5, "This they did, not as we hoped." And here's the key: "They first gave their own selves to the Lord and unto us by the will of God." Number 4, they were sold out. They were sold out. All we are, all we have, belongs to God. And if this is a need that we want to have a part in, that we want to help, God has laid it on our heart, we're going to do it. Because it all belongs to Him. They were sold out. Hannah had that attitude, didn't she? Hannah said, "Lord, I want a child so bad. If you'll just give me a child, I'll give him back to you. You can have him. At least I will have had a child." And she did just that. God gave her a child. She gave him back to the Lord. She visited him once a year after he was weaned, just once a year. And then, of course, God blessed her and gave her many more children that she was able to have at home. She was sold out. Matthew chapter 22. Matthew 22. Verse 17. This passage of scripture is very interesting. "Tell us, therefore," these are the Herodians that have come to tempt Jesus. "Tell us, therefore, what thinkest thou? Is it lawful to give tribute unto Caesar or not?" Now, they knew they had him. If Jesus said yes, then they could accuse him to the Jews. Well, if he's saying give tribute to Caesar, he can't be our Redeemer. He can't be the one to come to deliver Israel. If he says no, we can accuse him to the Romans. And he'll be arrested for telling people not to pay their taxes. So they knew they had him. He perceived their wickedness. He said, why tempt ye me, ye hypocrites? Show me the tribute money. And they brought unto him a penny. He said unto them, whose is this image and superscription? They say unto him, Caesar's. Then saith he unto them, render therefore unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and unto God the things that are God's. Now, often I've heard preachers say, well, there you go, you know, the tax belongs to Caesar and the tithe belongs to God. But that's not what I think he's saying here. Notice he says, whose is this image and superscription? That which bore the image of Caesar belonged to Caesar. Therefore, that which bore the image of God belongs to God. And what there was it that had God's image? The people themselves. You and I have God's image. Therefore, we, not just a part of us or what we have, we belong to God. And the Corinthians understood this, and they were sold out. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, Paul said, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. That God should die for man. How can it be? It's only reasonable that all we are and all we have is given over to him, for him to do with as he pleases. They were sold out. Notice verse 8. I speak not by commandment, but by occasion of the forwardness of others. And notice, to prove the sincerity of your love. Number 5, the sincerity of your love. It's easy to sing, oh, how I love Jesus, isn't it? Jesus asked his disciples, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? To prove the sincerity of your love. I say I love him. Okay, well, is he Lord? Am I surrendered? Am I yielded? Do I come to the Word of God? Do I come to the church services with the desire, Lord, please show me something in the Word to reveal an area in my life that I need to work on, a sin that I need to confess? Do I desire that closer relationship with the Lord day by day? Prove the sincerity of your love. And one way to do that is by our sacrificial giving. This is what he's dealing with here in this passage of Scripture. Proof. He tells the church at Corinth, he said, notice what the Macedonians have done. Now you prove the sincerity of your love. You say you love the Lord. You say you love the brethren. Well, prove it. Prove it. Then we come to verse 9. You know, we've talked a lot about Paul today. In every message, in fact, every text we used was written by Paul, and many people would say that he was no doubt the greatest missionary of all time. He was a great missionary, no doubt about that, but not the greatest. We find the greatest one here in verse 9. For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, what did he do? For your sakes, he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. The Savior's, number 6, the Savior's example. His example. We saw the example of the Macedonian Christians, but now let us consider the Savior's example. He gave his very lifeblood. He possessed the greatest love. He left the greatest homeland. He endured the greatest rejection. He made the greatest sacrifice, and he accomplished the greatest mission. Yes, Jesus, the greatest missionary of all time. And then finally, notice verse 11. Now therefore, perform the doing of it. Paul simply said, just do it. performed the doing of it. That as there was a readiness to will, you had the desire, your intentions, your motives were right, you wanted to do it. Now, that there may be a performance also out of that which ye have performed the doing of it. Number 7, success. The success of this is by just doing what God wants us to do, no more and no less. A couple of verses. He goes on with the same subject in chapter 9. Let's look at a couple of verses there. Verse 6. He which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. And he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. To me, that tells me if I'm stingy with God, God will be stingy with me. But if I'm liberal with the Lord, then he will be liberal with me. That's what that verse says. Verse 8. God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye always having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. In other words, if I faithfully do what I should do in this area, the grace of giving, then God is going to give me even more and meet all of my needs, not so that I can have more, but so that my needs can be met, and then I can even give more beyond that. That's what that verse is teaching there. Having always all sufficiency in all things may abound unto every good work. The promise of Philippians chapter 4 and verse 19, a promise that many, no doubt, of us have memorized, says, my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. That church at Philippi is one of these Macedonian churches. And that promise was given to a church that had sacrificed to give in that situation in Philippians chapter 4 to help the Apostle Paul as a missionary in his ministry. And now Paul gives them that promise, you've sacrificed to help me in my ministry, now God is going to provide all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. A man there was, some called him mad. The more he gave, the more he had. That's what the Bible teaches. As we are liberal and generous in our giving to the work of the Lord, God will take care of us. He's promised to do that. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and these things shall be added unto you. The basic needs of our daily life will be added unto us. That's a promise of God. I heard an evangelist several years ago tell about how that after a church service on a Sunday morning, the pastor was taking him to a family's in the church home for lunch, for their afternoon meal. And the pastor was saying, now, this couple we're going to visit, they've worked all their life and they saved their money so that they could build their dream home to retire in. And they just got moved in just not too long ago. And they're very, very thankful for the home that they were able to build and the Lord has provided for them. So they get to the house and they walk in and the pastor, the evangelist immediately notices that they've got all of the wood that you put down, like before you put the carpeting on top of it, they got all that wood down. But they don't have the carpeting yet. And so all the floors and all the house have got these 4x8 pieces of wood there and waiting for the carpeting. At least that's what the evangelist thought. And he made a comment about it. He said, wow, this is a wonderful home. This is really nice. He said, I bet you're going to be so thankful when you're able to finally get your carpeting put in. Well, nothing was said at the time, but after they ate, they went back in, sat down in the living room, and he said, I don't know why I did it, but I said something again about the floor. I said, boy, it's going to be so nice when you get your carpeting in. Well, the wife, she said to the evangelist, she said, we've saved all our life to build this home. And we had the money set aside to put the carpeting in our home. We had $16,000. We went to the carpet place on a Friday, picked out what we wanted for every room, had it all prepared, everything ready for them to come Monday. We were going to take the check by Monday morning, and they were going to come and install it. We were all ready to do that. She said, we went to church Sunday night, and we had a missionary there. And the pastor got up and he said, you know, he said, these missionaries, they've raised all their support. They had a rather large family. They've raised all their support. They're ready to go to the field. But they do not have the funds to get to the field. They're ready to go. He said, it's going to cost them $16,000 to get to the field. The wife said, I held the checkbook while my husband wrote out the check. She said, we will never have the funds to put carpeting in our floors. She said, but we call these our missionary floors. And we think they're beautiful. We think they're beautiful. The Lord never asks us to go anywhere that He has not gone, to face anything that He has not faced, to love anyone He has not loved, or to give anything that He has not given. I close with a verse from the Old Testament where David, after they assembled all that they were going to gather for the temple to be built by Solomon, he said, all things come of thee, and of thine own have we given thee. Of thine own have we given thee. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the example of the Macedonians. Thank you even more for the example of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, you want us to enjoy the blessings of life that you have provided for us. And yet, Lord, help us to lift up our eyes on the fields that are white unto harvest and be faithful, following your direction and how we use that which you've entrusted to us to further your work around the world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Pastor?
All right, thank you. Here is love, page 113. 113, here is love. We'll stand together and sing this before we depart today. 113, here is love.
Thank you.
these expressions of praise to you. Thank you for teaching us today and reminding us of your truth, mission that you've left us here to be involved in, to participate in. Thank you for the privilege of knowing you and serving you, and meeting along the way others that know you and are serving you, the privilege of singing of your love for us and our responsive love to you. And may we live out this week the things that we have learned today. May we live out our lives in conviction based upon the truth that you've revealed. And may you have your way in continuing to renew our minds and transform us, that we might be changed from glory to glory. We might reflect you. We praise you in Christ's name. Amen. You're dismissed.